thank you everybody for coming to this, the last of these faculty luncheon series presentations for 2014. I'm glad to see so many people here. I know there are many different conflicts on our time this time of year, from exams to I hear that President Thrasher is meeting with the faculty union right now, so lots of things that are happening. I'm Paul Hardy, I'm a professor in the School of Information, and I'm delighted to MC this event today. Our speakers today are Rob Duarte, who is an assistant professor in the Department of Art, and Jonathan Clark, who is an associate professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. And we've been having a lot of fun talking over lunch about the combination of arts and engineering. I don't know how many of you know, but many of us in the School of Information have backgrounds in engineering and go into other fields that eventually lead us toward the information sciences. My background is in computer engineering, and Michelle Cashman, who's also a professor at the School of Information, is her background in mechanical engineering. So engineering, you never know where things are going to take you, and it's always wonderful to see these sorts of collaborations take place. As a reminder, our spring series is going to continue with this combination of themes. So we'll be focusing on science, technology, and humanities at FAMU-FSU in the spring. And we have speakers from Department of Classics, Italian Modern Languages and Linguistics, the College of Medicine, and the Department of English talking about their research in those areas. You may have seen the announcement that went out about that yesterday. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to our two guest speakers to tell you about their research combining engineering and art and the topic of mechatronics. Thank you very much.
Okay, so this is kind of a second introduction. I just wanted to give you an idea of what we'll be talking about, and then I'll hand it over to Jonathan. Jonathan will kind of start out, and we'll give you an idea of what mechatronics is. We promise we didn't make up the term. That's actually all that Jonathan does. And then I'll give you an idea of some maybe history of collaborations between artists and technology, or artists and engineers. And then we'll give you an idea of what we're planning for our collaborative class between the art students and engineering students. So here's Jonathan.
Thanks, Rob. All right. Can you hear me without the microphone?
Probably better.
All right, good.
I don't think that microphone's picking anything up. Can you hear it?
If you stand right in front of the speaker, you can hear stuff.
Oh.
So, like I said, I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, Rob, for that a little bit. I'm going to try to keep myself down from the hour and 15 minute usual lecture that I give down to about 15 minutes. Hard to do. Incidentally, I work in the Aeropropulsion Mechatronics and Engineering building, so the AME building. So this term mechatronics has existed for many years to describe this joint area. So go ahead and go to the next slide here. So the first question is what we're talking about here. What is mechatronics? And it's a term that sort of combines the mechanical and electronics together into mechatronics. So it's this intersection between electrical and mechanical domains. We think of this often in terms of creating products or artifacts that have some kind of both mechanical essence, they exist physically, and they have some kind of intelligence. So we think of these often as smart products. So all of us have smartphones in our pockets, but we also have lots of products around us that have embedded intelligence in them. So we're talking about connecting these computers with artifacts or mechanisms or machines so they can interact with the world and they can change the way that they interact with the world depending upon the circumstances. Okay. So if you look at this figure on the right, which can pop up. So within engineering, we think of mechatronics as being the intersection of these three domains, mechanical, electrical, and software. And in the center of this is mechatronics. So we draw from each of these. I belong to a mechanical engineering department, so when I teach mechatronics to my students, I spend a lot of time teaching electrical and software kinds of applications. When it's taught from electrical engineering's perspective, they emphasize more on the mechanical and so forth and so on. But it's this intersection of these domains that creates interesting opportunities. So on the next slide, I'm going to look at a couple examples of systems that are designed to regulate behavior that exist in individual domains, just to give you a sense of what it looks like when they're not combined. And then the rest of the presentation will be talking about how we can combine these various parts. So the first one here in the blue is a pressure regulator. So if you have some kind of inlet which has some kind of pressure or fluid flowing through it, and you want to make sure that the output or the outlet there has the same exact, the correct pressure that's moving, flowing through it, you have a device that looks like this. The pressure goes in, it expands that area with a diaphragm, and then as that diaphragm expands, it pulls up the poppet valves, which slows the amount of fluid flowing in, And so then the fluid drops, and so the pressure drops, and so the outflow drops, and it regulates itself. So the outlet pressure is always at a constant value. So this is a purely mechanical device. Over here is the electrical analog of this. It's a circuit which is designed to regulate voltage. So if you hook this up to a battery that can vary from 6 to 7.2 volts, but you want a nice clean 5-volt output, a 5-volt output that's going to power your electronics, you use a device like this that uses the same kinds of principles, but it's all done with electronics. It's all done in the voltage domain. The third example here is a computer simulation of a cardiac regulation. So this is a mathematical model that's been captured in software and built and programmed in to capture some kind of system. Like here is the way we regulate or beat the beating of our hearts. But there's pros and cons to each one of these domains. The great thing about mechatronics is it allows you to use the intelligence and sophistication of computation and electrical systems and combine them with physical systems that can interact with the real world. So there's a lot of exciting possibilities for combining these things, which are all powerful in their own right, together to create products, artifacts, parts of our world that can then respond to people in changing ways. Okay, so those are some examples. So what comprises a mechatronic system? So when we teach this, I teach a mechatronics class now. Rob teaches a mechatronics class as well. What do we teach our students? Well, mechatronics belongs to, so it's comprised of a number of different components. At some point, you've got actuators, things that interact with the world, that move. And you also have a set of, down below here, a set of sensors. These are things that perceive the world, everything from sensing sound, touch, light, ultrasonic, pressure, force. All kinds of these sensors sense what's happening in the world. The heart of it is some kind of computer system, either a small individual chips or full-on computers like you see in your desktop, laptop. And then, of course, there's a software component to this, which embeds the intelligence and say, how am I going to react? And so this is how the system works. On the left here, you can see that there's the world. We take things that happen in the world and we sense them. We transduce physical quantities and turn them into electrical signals. They then go to a microcontroller. The microcontroller then talks with the software, figures out what to do, and then that informs the actuators that then do work on the world itself. So then we either turn on LEDs, or we push chairs around, or we open doors, or we regulate the flow through a piece of machinery, and we complete this cycle. And this is what comprises a mechatronic system that has both the electrical and mechanical part. All right, so what's interesting about mechatronics, in particular with regards to this collaboration between mechatronics and art? So we saw that we can have purely mechanical feedback systems, purely electrical feedback systems, and purely software feedback systems, but when you can put these things together, it allows you to do things that are much more complex, much smaller, and much less expensive. And so they become pervasive. So these are the kinds of things that you can see throughout our lives and throughout society. This gives us the smarts of computers. It allows us to take machines and give them a form of life, because they behave differently depending on the circumstances. And so to the extent that these things mimic the behavior of animals or of humans, we call them robots. So normally when I introduce myself, I talk about myself as that I do robotics. That's sort of my field of research. And I'm going to talk a little bit about my field of research specifically as bio-inspired dynamic legged robots. So how do you build robots that use legs to move around in the world in ways that are bio-like, that build on some of the examples and principles of what animals have done? So this is arguably the most famous legged robot. It was a few years ago, built by Honda. It's Asimo. Here's walking across the stage. It can do any number of things, has a large number of degrees of freedoms, costs millions of dollars to build. It's a very sophisticated system. But when you look at the locomotion, it doesn't quite look right. It's not moving the same way animals do. So if we watch this video here, this is a film of a squirrel. I loved watching squirrels when I was a kid. My mom loved to feed the birds, and so the squirrels always got the bird feed no matter what we did. And so we'd create these complicated contractions to keep the squirrels away, and they'd always find a way to get to the food. So this is clearly not a squirrel acting in its natural environment, but it does demonstrate some of the versatility and the agility of natural systems and how they move. And you contrast this to our robots who we've been able to build, we can see that we still have a long ways to go. So we've begun to mimic these things, but we've got a long way to go between we've fully captured this bio-inspired and creating synthetic devices that have the intelligence and the agility of animals. So there's lots of ways people have tried to copy or be inspired from biology. The most obvious of which is morphology. I could build a robot that looks like a squirrel, or one that looks like an ape, or one that, like Asimo, that looks like a little small human being. And there's lots of other levels. The one that I spend most of my time thinking about is the bottom one here, we call dynamic templates, which is essentially the motion of the system, the underlying dynamics. How do we get things that move with the agility of, say, that squirrel jumping and landing and climbing? How do we capture and imbue that into mechanical systems? So that's a lot of my research area. So the fundamental idea here is that the underlying motion of these very, very different animals, squirrels, centipedes, cockroaches, kangaroos, can all be modeled with very simple mathematical, what we call templates. So the little figures here on the right are models of walking and running. So we think of ourselves as just one point mass of the hip and a rigid leg, and I walk like this, right? Which is obviously there's a lot more going on. Or I think of running where I do the same thing, but now I've got springiness in my leg. So the underneath of my foot flexes and my Achilles tendon stores some energy. And that storage and energy return allows me to capture what happens when I'm running. One thing I like about these simple models is they allow the construction of devices like this. This is a mechanism. It's purely mechanical. There's no sensors, there's no electronics, there's no actuators. But its walking style is much more human-like than the million-dollar Asimo with tons of computational power. Why? Well, hopefully it's because it captures some of the underlying dynamics of motion. And this is the stuff that I get excited about. So here's a couple slides of the things I'm doing. So this is running, early running robots. They took inspiration from things like how humans run or our old friends the cockroaches. They're actually really good runners. And we built robots that can hop and run. This is the 80s. This is Mark Rabert, the first-legged running robot. We do a lot of math around it. If you click one more time, you can see a video of what happens if you get this right. You get to do really cool things, right? And so we're struggling to build these things into robots that can move throughout our world. So a little bit about some of the robots that I've built here. Again, inspired by the cockroach. We look at how they move. Here it's being poked and prodded. It runs over obstacles without really seeing. It relies on its physical structure. Passive joints in the structure of its legs combined with active forcing of the legs allows us to create robots like this that run like this. So it's simple. This is only has a single actuator, one motor. The legs just go in and out real fast. But when you put it in contact with the environment, interesting things happen. Right? So it begins to run and move a little bit like our old friend the cockroach, right? Even though it's a very, very simple mechanical device. It's that interaction between the electromechanical system and the environment that produces the really interesting results. All right, on the right, we all looked at climbing. I've done a lot of my work on climbing. This is a gecko climbing up a vertical wall. If you click on this and you see a model of it, you can watch how the body undulates back and forth as it climbs very, very rapidly. And so we've been able to create very simple models of the mathematics of the thing as it climbs. And then we build these into robots. So if you go to the next slide, we can see some robots who were designed to run across the ground, like the other ones you've seen. The same robot can change its morphology and then climb up walls. So this is the kind of research we're doing, to try to capture the dynamics of motion, try to get mechanical devices that can operate in more than one regime. All right. So one last slide about my research is we're working on, one more time, building small, inexpensive robots that are pervasive and that can work in natural environments. So this is a little one. You may have to go back up and play that video again. It starts off a little bit slow. A little robot we built that's designed to climb up walls, even though it looks kind of funny. It doesn't look anything like a squirrel, but it can climb up vertical walls. But then, much like a flying squirrel, it can jump off, engage its wings. In this case, they're rigidly fixed rather than being flexible patagium, but then pull into a nice glide and fly away to the next tree. So we're trying to create small, inexpensive robots that can be pervasive, capture how animals move, and then move around in the complex world we live in. Turns out the hardest thing about robots is getting them to interact with the complexities of the real world. That's really hard. Just in terms of moving, it's hard, but in terms of understanding and conceptual understanding, that becomes a really hard problem. Which brings us back to the point. When these mechatronic devices, which we can build to do cool things, they can exhibit different behaviors. But the exciting behaviors come when they interact with the environment or they interact with people, which is what brings us to my interaction with Rob. And Rob's going to talk a little bit more about the ideas of what does it mean when these devices interact with the world or interact with people, and how do we interact with them. And so I'm going to give him the mic for a minute and talk a little bit about mechatronics art.
I'm not feeling very well, so I'm going to try and actually use the mic. Does it make any difference? Okay. So part of what I wanted to go over is just some of the history, because I think for most people they think, well, how could this possibly relate to art, and when has this ever happened? But actually, there's a pretty long history of this. We could go back as early as maybe Da Vinci, but you know, just in recent history, we can look at someone like John Tingley. This is a pretty famous piece called Homage to New York, where he worked with an engineer from Bell Labs, Billy Kluver, and also another artist, Robert Rauschenberg, and created this kind of spectacle that destroyed itself and was kind of created panic and was shut down by the fire department. But in the end, it was about this kind of commentary on industrialization and mechanization, and it was that collapse that was kind of metaphorical in some ways. Keep going. So that same guy from Bell Labs, Billy Kluver, went on, and Robert Rauschenberg as well, and some other pretty well-known artists, and they all collaborated on this project called Experiments in Art and Technology. And they basically kind of combined theater and engineering and created this really interesting performance called Nine Evenings. This is in the mid-60s, and it, even though it was, I mean, really kind of technically a huge feat at the time, it was electronics and mechanics. So it didn't kind of include this third component, which Jonathan was describing as making up mechatronics, and that would be like some kind of computation. But then soon after, in that lineage, there was this really kind of monumental show called Cybernetic Serendipity. And now, you know, as time goes on, this is what artists do. They're responding to culture at the time. And so this is now the next evolution of it, thinking about culture that's surrounded by software and information and data. And this is kind of the next evolution, where we're talking about smart machines and robotics and computation as being a part of it. Much later, this is kind of like more recent history. Chris Byrne is a pretty well-known sculptor, and this is a piece called When Robots Rule the Two-Minute Airplane Factory. So he worked with a group of engineers to create this machine that would be able to do this, what you would think is a pretty simple act of creating a paper airplane and then launching it on the other end. So this, I think, was at the Tate Modern, and you know, part of this title and the implication of building a machine like this and seeing this kind of engineering feat is that somehow this is indicative of the world that we live in, and that we should really kind of be maybe worried about, like, you know, robots and technology kind of taking over. But the truth is, the machine really never worked. It kind of, for 99% of the time, it just kind of sat there. They tried to repair it, and it only ever made one airplane, and that was in a glass vitrine in the museum. So that was as far as it went. So you know, you also have to think, given Chris Burton and this kind of critique that he was always making in this vein, that that's kind of part of it. I don't know that he ever expected it to work, but you can see it's like it's a pretty serious effort to actually make this happen. This is kind of interesting when you look at something like a running squirrel or a cockroach, that you think it's kind of this simple thing, but the reality is a lot more complicated. So. This is kind of where my interest is. This is where my research comes in. This is a nice summary by this guy, Arnold Pacey. He kind of came up with this idea that, you know, when we talk about technology, what we're really talking about is this just tip of the iceberg, which is the technical part of it. But really, there's all this whole other world involved with technology that's political and social and cultural. And so that human aspect is my interest and what I try to introduce to my students and to get them thinking about. So I could start with this maxim: all technology is political. There's political ideology built in everything, from the mechanism that keeps that door open to you know, something more high tech. And this guy, Chris Csikszentmihalyi, had a lab at the MIT Media Lab called Computing Culture, and it was pretty unique in that organization, and that it was really focused on thinking about the politics of technology and bringing that to the front through these kind of subversive projects, things that were really provocative and bordered up maybe on activism. This is a friend who went through that program, Anina Roost, and she created this kind of like garter belt that would sense the amount of power that you were using in your house, and it would communicate it to this device, and you would be wearing this on your leg, and it would, it's this really interesting planetary gear that would cause these little spikes to come out and puncture your legs. So the more power you were using in your house, the more it would inflict pain on you. So it's kind of like, it was described in the New York Times or something as your carbon penance. And this is another project which was, really kind of, both of these come from an engineering perspective, but they really are more than trying to solve a technical problem. They're really about generating questions. And so this one, even though it's the mechanism is really about this ability of clothing to sense shaking or something like this, some kind of violent action, it is kind of couched in this proposal that it could somehow be a way of alerting someone when there's domestic violence or something like this. So in this framing of it, this is kind of the difference between art and engineering, maybe, is the goals, but they're using some of the same language, the same tools, same processes. With that in mind, here's another kind of precedent to what we're doing, which is critical design. So this is coming from a design perspective, and that term was coined by Anthony Dunn and Fiona Raby at the Royal College of Art. And they would consider themselves designers, but a lot of the products were really more in the realm of art, because they were not trying to solve problems in the way that design does, but they were trying to be provocative and ask questions about the things that we produce, the way that we design and engineer the world around us, and think about what else is possible. If we're not thinking about things that are user-friendly, then can we think about things that are instead maybe more poetic or personal? And some of it takes on this kind of sci-fi aesthetic, which is handy, and actually I think will be handy in our collaborative course as a way of thinking about kind of culture right now, thinking about ethical problems, political problems, and putting them out in 100 years into the future and imagining that. So that could be, that's kind of a nice way to approach problems like that sometimes. And a related kind of project, this is a group of artists that created this idea of critical engineering, and they have this amazing manifesto that is, I think, numbers 0 through 10. Everything starts in 0 in engineering. So it's a nice way of thinking about the status quo of engineering and thinking about what else is possible. This is a project that maybe fit in with either of those, right? And it's called Phone Blocks. This was all over Facebook a couple of years ago. And I mean, it's great. And I think for most people it's great in a really practical sense, like, oh, this is what my phone's going to look like. But technically it's probably not really that possible, but it's interesting as more of a provocation to think about this kind of disposable culture that we live in. So this is a phone that is not only customizable and personalizable, it's and upgradable in the way that you want. It also just makes us start to think about the idea of repair, something that's kind of foreign to our culture, and that we don't kind of partake in this system of getting a new phone every 6 months and throwing the old one into the recycling bin, which actually means handing it off to some other place where we don't have to look at it. So this is maybe the same kind of provocation that we would categorized as like critical engineering, critical design, and it's definitely in the realm of artists to kind of provoke these kinds of questions. So in the critical design description, they are saying the opposite of critical design is affirmative design that supports or affirms the status quo of design. So if we think about something like a 3D printer, on its surface, it has lots of possibilities for artists, for kind of just culture in general. What we end up making a lot is just whistles and bunnies. So, what I'm typically doing with these kinds of tools with my students is asking them to ask the more important questions and to approach this in a way that considers all of this this examination, this critical examination of the politics of technology. This is a good example of that. This is kind of much, this is in the early 70s, Mark Pauline started this thing called Survival Research Labs, where he created, with a team of people who were kind of engineer artists, created these giant robots, and they... It's an announcement before the ringing, I like that. created these giant robots that basically almost sort of just seem to fight each other. They're these insane spectacles on a giant scale. But they're absolutely a critique of culture and art, techno culture. So he takes kind of the tools and the processes of industry, of commerce, of warfare, and puts it in this kind of play. And if you remember from the 90s, there's like robot wars and battle bots. And so that's kind of, you know, drawing from this work. I don't think that would have ever existed without this artwork, except what it's done is it's kind of sanitized it. It's stripped away all of the political content, and it's turned it into something that's purely entertainment. So this is the kind of printing of whistles and bunnies with the MakerBot versus doing something of some substance. So. That's kind of the battle, the struggle that we're always going through in having art and technology together. But it's not always all serious and grim and about the skepticism and trying to coax out the politics. Sometimes it's just also kind of fun. But you know, this is a project that. I don't know this person's actual name. It's Mud Level Works. I think that's like his kind of graffiti name. But he made this. The video is kind of nice because you don't really know what's going on till the end. But he made this contraption that makes graffiti, and so you could say that graffiti immediately is kind of a political gesture. And also, there's something about the clunkiness of this that has some of the same kind of commentary on just the way that we engineer things. But in the end, it just is a trailer that. When he presses a button, it does this. So it's just kind of like a nice poetic gesture. So that's maybe some of the other possibilities of integrating these tools and processes from engineering into like an art practice. I have no idea where we are on time because I thought we'd have the presenter view, but I'm going to skip the video.
We're doing great.
Okay. Oh, okay. So this is a piece of mine that kind of combines all of those things. It has a certain like accessible and fun component to it, but it's also kind of that same kind of critical look at kind of the mechanisms of violent warfare type machines. But it. Basically blows up a balloon like a person would in breaths, and then when it bursts, you can't really see it anymore, but there's kind of this theatrical lighting, and when the balloon's shadow reaches that spotlight, it bursts, and then it recognizes that the balloon's burst, and it ejects this brass shell that it's connected to, and then another one takes its place, and it starts over again. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of this... you know, like Sisyphean act that it takes, and this is I'm kind of drawing a little bit from Survival Research Labs, and then I'm thinking of this as a performance by this machine, and this is some of the path that I've been on. And so this last slide, I think for me, but so we've got like critical design and critical engineering, which kind of took that. To the engineering realm instead of design. And then this other term, which is related, called critical making. And this is something that's kind of in use right now. This guy, Matt Ratto, came up with that term. And part of it is about this idea of learning about the world that we live in through this really hands-on and experiential way, and that there's some value in working in that hands-on way, taking things apart and examining them. So that's part of what we're trying to introduce in our class, and part of what I do in all of my classes, which is to draw on this sort of hacking ethos, which is inherently political, but is also about kind of taking things apart and voiding warranties to kind of look behind the curtain. And so part of what we're trying to do in our class is to bring students into that way of thinking and learning with their hands, which is maybe less common than in the past. So I think we'll talk about that a bit. So, I don't know, should we just both stand up here and talk over each other by accident? Or?
Yeah, I'll just talk over you from back here. I'll project my voice.
I gotta the slides, one. Right. Yeah, okay, we'll trade. Okay.
That's right. So right now we both teach mechatronics classes. So I teach it to mechanical engineering students, and we focus on the tools of mechatronic design. How do you program microprocessors? How do sensors work? And the details of that. Rob similarly teaches an analogous class in the art department.
Right, and it's called Mechatronic Art. We go over some of the same techniques. I've taught it once, but really it'll start in earnest this fall as kind of a precursor to our collaborative class. So we're finally getting in sync, where we each teach our class in the fall, and then our collaborative class will happen in the spring.
Right. So there's some, as we've been discussing, our experiences of teaching this class and working with students, there's been some insights into some good things that have happened, and there's some limitations that our students have. There's some issues that we have as instructors, as teachers. We wish they would learn to see things a little bit deeper and approach solving the problems in that. For example, when we ask them to understand a topic, their first response is, whip out my phone and Google it, right? Rather than going to a variety of sources and looking at history and digging a little bit deeper. When I ask my engineering students to come up with a design, they immediately sit down in a CAD program and spend hours and hours coming up with a very detailed, specific solution to the problem, which will not work. Guaranteed, it will not work. And then they have to go back and redesign it. It's completely ineffectual because they're locked into this mindset of using their computer tools, rather than thinking through the problem and going through iterations in a more organic way of beginning with sketches and going to more detailed drawings and going to simple prototypes. They just don't think that way. And so this is one of the things that that I think there's a little bit of this in the art department as well, but certainly my students need to have sort of a better way of approaching solving problems.
Right, and you'd almost think this is where the art students come in and teach the engineering students the right way, but actually this has been my experience as well. Like, we need always more sketching, more cardboard models, and working through it iteratively in that same way that engineering students would like to have them do it.
So the second problem is that I teach the class and I spend a lot of time teaching the fundamentals, the tools, and there's not enough time for them to actually use those tools to create and express something, to create an artifact, to solve a problem, to synthesize all the various tools in order to create an object that actually solves a problem, actually does something. And it's in that interaction that the richness comes. So the class I teach is finally the last week of the semester. They're able finally to put the mechanical parts and the electrical parts and the software parts all together, and they realize that it doesn't work. Because that interaction, that bringing the pieces together, creates new problems just as it creates new opportunities. And so by creating a second class that's a project-based class, we might be able to address this problem, that they don't have a chance to really use these tools and experience the pros and the cons of using them beyond a sort of manufactured, artificial classroom problem. Did you want to say anything on that, Rahman?
Well, no, but if that's a problem in engineering, you can imagine it's a much bigger problem for us to do that in the art department, because the engineering students at least have some of that background already. They already have some of the electronics and maybe the programming. We do have kind of a common kind of set of background that we can draw on. Our students, or my students generally, do have some programming experience, and of course, like, there's some of the same software tools. But they don't have quite the background. So for us, it would be a great benefit to be able to kind of spend more time on that kind of, on those basic skills that kind of feed into mechatronics, and then come together with the engineering students to make something of more significance. So I think the students and we would like that a lot better.
So here are some examples of projects that my students have built in classes, in mechatronics classes. So we have a remote controlled car that's driven by motions of your arms. You have EKG sensors in your arms, so you move your arms around, the car can drive around, and there's a little backpack you wear on your hip that connects up the electronics to the car on the left. We built some robots here that go and either play frisbee golf. This is a useful life skill. And so it'll shoot a disc, it'll go find that disc, reposition itself, find the target, and try to iteratively approach the target. Or one that picks up cans, so it goes around and finds cans and picks them up and brings them to the trash. Or the bottom right is an inverted pendulum, where the goal is to balance the rod upside down by moving the cart back and forth. This is sort of an application of basic control theory that we use in dynamics controls classes. And so I had some students last year who built this mechanism. So you look at these things, and these are the kinds of problems that engineers, the kinds of devices that engineers build. Now, I wouldn't exactly say that these are beautiful devices. Some of them function well, but there's not really much thought that my students give to how is this going to interact with the user? How are the people or the world, how is that interaction going to inform the design of the device, and how is the device going to affect the people? We don't get to that point of thinking about things like that.
Let's trade for these last couple of slides. You can be on camera.
Okay. All right. You want to talk about this one, Rob, now that you're not in the spotlight anymore?
Yeah. And so, I'm really just now, partly because of parental leave and also because I'm fairly new, that I'm still trying to get to the point where we have this mechatronics class. We've led up to all of these skills getting to our collaborative class. So now, I'm teaching a class called Digital Fabrication, and then Mechatronic Art, and then that will lead into our collaborative class. So these are actually projects from a place where I was teaching before here at the University of San Diego, where I did teach a Mechatronic Art class there. And so these are just like some of the projects that those students did. On the top, there was this statue that had a broken, Jesus had a broken hand, and so one of the students made this prosthesis by casting actually a child's hand and made this kind of resin cast, and then it was like this prosthesis that would respond when you came to visit the statue. And then in the lower left, part of this was kind of creating these robots that had some kind of personality, and so he made this kind of totally macho welded metal sculpture that had these Barbie braids, and it had like varying sorts of behaviors from really basic inputs and outputs. It would twirl these braids and kind of get angry and try and chase you, and then the same with this grotesque kind of worm thing on the right, where it would do its best to try and follow you around, but it really was just kind of rolling around and scraping with that stick that came out of the front. So our idea is that, of course, this is going to be better for the students in some of the ways that we already said. It'll extend the classes that each of us have, and there is some common background that we'll be able to take advantage of, but we'll be able to propel that everything that they're doing forward a lot more, because they'll be able to rely on each other. They'll also have more significant time to work on a project of a larger scope.
Yeah, one of the things that I'm excited about is this opportunity for peer teaching and learning, so this peer-to-peer learning. So we're going to get a bunch of mechanical engineering students and a bunch of art students, and they're not going to know how to talk to each other. And this is something that we see in engineering all the time. We don't know how to talk to non-engineers. And they certainly don't know how to think like an artist. And so one of the things I'm most excited about is getting these people, these students together, and having them be very, very uncomfortable at the beginning of the class. And then requiring them to explain some of the basic principles that they've learned in their undergraduate studies to their teammates who they're going to be working with on a project, so they can develop a common language. And that will force them to be able to distill down what they think is important and communicate it to their teammates. And simultaneously, they'll be learning from their teammates new ways of thinking and new skills. This is one of the things I'm most excited about this class.
Yeah, of course, they're learning from each other. They're also learning how to distill all of the education that they've had, but it's a really practical skill to be able to talk to people outside of your domain after you leave school, of course. So these are some of the goals that we have. Obviously, it's interdisciplinary, but part of that is not just this exchange of technical knowledge, but kind of cultural similarities and differences, and having that happen through working together in groups, and this idea of focusing on doing these things in a hands-on way. Obviously, the art students, without all of that prerequisite knowledge, that prerequisite technical knowledge, aren't relying heavily on theory, and so what we have to do is a lot of experimentation and hands-on learning.
Which the engineering students desperately need.
So. Perfect. And then hopefully the idea is that what happens during that semester will culminate in this final exhibition that may be able to happen at the Challenger Learning Center. Is that what it's called? Yeah.
Someplace, some kind of public place for the students to get a chance to display their work at the end. So that's the plan right now. And so we thank you for giving us a few minutes to talk about it, talk about some of the ideas, and we'll now open it up for questions.
Carolyn's the chair of the art department, and so she ran into Jonathan somehow and said, "You teach a class called mechatronics, and there's one called mechatronic art."
this is really exciting. I agree, it's exciting. And Paul, thank you for getting these guys to stage this, because I wouldn't have seen it. Along those lines, how do you get, Rob, you were talking about the evolution of some of these processes. So how do you know two things? One is who and where something's happening, say, this week, that might really be pushing the envelope. And I wonder how you keep up with that. And then the other thing, I guess the other side of that coin is, if you're working on something, say your students are working on something, how do they know whether somebody else has already taken on this project, this kind of challenge, maybe more or less successfully? In other words, how do you share that knowledge outside, say, the room?
Well, luckily, I'm very interested in this, so I'm kind of always on the lookout. But this is also kind of how our art classes work. We look at a lot of artwork. We talk about artwork that isn't just the student work, but you know, it's always in comparison to what has happened, what else is happening. So that's just kind of built into the way that we do things in a normal class. You know, some part of it is based on critique and evaluation, but also we're always paying attention to kind of history. So I love kind of, there's a lot of this really recent history that I still find and I'm really excited about, but most of my students aren't aware of it. And so it's great for me. I'm always introducing that stuff. As far as what's happening now, my students are also on top of that. I mean, a lot of what happens, this kind of robo rainbow machine, you know, this is something that maybe a student even introduced me to it. It's just these things pop up on YouTube or Vimeo or something, and then we start chasing that down and find out who that person is friends with. And so a lot of it is kind of this just seeking these things out, I guess. Sure.
Mm-hmm. So it's part of our time, right, is making use of it. There's the interchange of information is much faster now. But ideas all have histories, right? And so I gave you like 10 seconds of some of the history of legged robots. And Rob gave you, 5 minutes of the history of technology and art. But understanding that history is a lot of what we try to get into our students' head. As one of my old professors used to say, all design is redesign. There's almost nothing that you're going to see or touch that was not built on something else and just modified and tweaked. And almost all of what we do as engineers is we modify and tweak what was done before. I don't know if I can speak with confidence for art students, but almost everything that gets created is not created in a vacuum. It's an expression and a reflection and an extension of the world they live in. And so this is a lot of what it is taking the world that these students live in, right? For them, it's an interconnected digital world. But it's also being able to connect that to the history of the field that gives them the ability to push things forward. And I think that's part of our mandate as teachers, is to help them understand both the history and the context of where they're living today. So that's a good question. Thanks.
I'm also excited about this overlap for us, because I use that phrase at least once a semester. So all design is redesign. I'd like to know where that originally came from.
So the students are undergraduates, are they undergraduate majors?
So the students who take my class are usually seniors or first-year graduate students. And so this would be offered in the spring term, so after they've taken the class that I already, so it'll be their last year of undergraduate or they'll be graduate students.
So I'm in the digital media area of the art department, and then we have kind of separate focus areas within that, kind of separate tracks that students can follow. So it's kind of a way for them to assemble courses in a like meaningful way. And there's, I guess I'm kind of the guy for digital plus forms. So the idea is that we have a sequence of courses, and this would hopefully be kind of like the last semester culminating from these other courses, physical computing, digital fabrication, and mechatronic art, the precursor to this course. So the hope is that we've got a group of all seniors, maybe people who are really invested by that time, and that's kind of like a capstone.
Maybe a year ago, I asked some of the people who've been at the faculty luncheons for the past couple of years and how to help me remember. We had a presentation by a young associate professor, and I think he was in nanoscience, and he talked about his philosophy was that life is a machine, and that's fine. But his approach was, as I understand some of the nanoscience, creating machines that go into the body to do functions that a surgeon, for instance, may otherwise be required to do. I don't know if that interfaces with what you guys are doing or not.
There's an artist that I mean, I have a million slides, but this artist, Stellark, who initially did a lot of these performances that were just about the human body and then kind of evolved through all these iterations over the years. And he's grown an ear on his arm using this whole, so he works with engineers in kind of nanotechnology and also biology and has grown this actual arm that will at some point function and people on the internet will hear what his ear hears. But he also has these kind of, I don't know that this is kind of his next evolution, is these tiny robots that could enter your body. And I don't know what he plans to have
I'm
them
sorry,
do.
I but call his professor's name. Yeah. I don't even know if he's still at FSU, but he did he was a speaker here. Really, really fascinating.
Yeah, there's a host of technical challenges, which are interesting in and of themselves. But any time it sort of comes into our body, all of a sudden we go, right? And rightly so, because it becomes very personal. And so this is one of those domains where we as engineers get excited about the technical challenges. And we don't always stop and think about, what have I just done, right? And I think it's really helpful as we train engineers, we give them examples where they are forced to think carefully about what are we doing, right? And what are the implications of this? And what is this, what are the, you know, the law of unintended consequences? And at least to begin to contemplate what some of those are going to be. I think that's a valuable piece of the education that we normally neglect because we're so busy teaching them equations and you know, tools.
I think that's where the collaboration kind of started for me, is that that's mostly what I'm thinking about, especially with my students, is kind of the implications of that kind of thing.
Well, on that note, Roger, you mentioned political. Thank you. And I wonder about drones. I mean, are there people developing drones who are sort of listening in on what you guys are doing?
I don't know. I can check and see. No, drones is actually really interesting. You probably don't want to get me started on this, but it's sort of people have been building sort of unmanned flying craft for a long time, and then all of a sudden they got this label of drone, and they started certain class of them started dropping bombs, and all of a sudden everybody got really worried, and it was, rightly so, we started getting worried about our privacy, right? Because they can fly around. It's like any other sort of thing. You open up Pandora's box, and there's all kinds of potential problems. I have in the past been excited about the technical challenges behind getting those to work well. And there's a lot of good that they can do. But like anything else, there's a lot of issues that get raised. And I love the fact, that, or hate the fact, depending on the day, that society has termed them drones. That's not a term of art that's used in the engineering community. It's the news media that started calling them drones, and now it's stuck. And it has this sort of pejorative aspect to it. Which bothers a lot of people who are doing sort of the fundamental science and using these things for useful things, right? If we're going to do like crop monitoring, right? You want us to be able to send flying unmanned things around there to do detailed, you can't do that. It's against the rules. You can't fly anything that's unmanned because there's a privacy issue. And like, I can double my crop yield if I do this. No, you don't want it. You can't do that, right? So there's an interesting interplay between those.
I just wanted to say thank you again to our wonderful speakers.